Let's pray together. Our gracious God, I just pray that these words may be taken by your Spirit to glorify you, our Father, and honor our Lord Jesus Christ and build us up as your people gathered in this place. For I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's nice to be back in the land of the living. And so my welcome to all, looks like someone's going to really not last the whole distance, given that cough. But my belated welcome to the Dean's Chapel, especially to returning and new students, any staff, faculty, of course. Special thanks to Dr. Carson for preaching in my place last week. He preached on the theme of faith and he had such short notice, I'm sure it was an exercise in the same. Now, this is the 500th year anniversary of the Reformation, and our chapel series, as you probably know by now, reflects it. So over the fall semester, there'll be sermons on this sola and that sola and yet another sola. And of course, Dr. Carson preached on faith, as I said, faith alone last week. It's a year of special lectures and conferences, pilgrimages to holy sites like Wittenberg and Zurich and Geneva and Canterbury. And here at TEDS, we too celebrate this great anniversary of the Reformation. Indeed, next week we're going to have our own Reformation conference. But you know, in other places, not so much. And I'm not talking about the Vatican. Last month, in Australia, I was at a college I'd never been to before, and I was introduced to a faculty member. When he heard I was giving a lecture on the Reformation as part of the Moore College celebration of the Reformation, my old college, he fiercely said the Reformation was a disaster, his words. I must say, the more he talked about the Reformation, the less I recognized it. You see, whatever else the Reformation was, it was an attempt to retrieve the gospel of the New Testament, especially as found in Paul's letters. And one of those retrievals was the notion of union with Christ, which is our topic for today. And I don't believe its importance can be disputed. Listen to theologian Matthew Barrett and what he's going to say about it in a forthcoming book. Union with Christ is not one step or stage in the order of salvation, but rather is the umbrella category that undergirds and underlies every aspect of salvation. The umbrella category that undergirds and underlies every aspect of salvation. As for our 16th century reformers, Luther provides just one example of a reformer who saw the importance of union with Christ. He wrote this in a classic of Christian theology, Freedom of the Christian Man, from 1520. He wrote that the third incomparable benefit of faith is that it unites the soul with Christ as a bride united with her bridegroom. By this mystery, as the apostle teaches, he writes, Christ and the soul become one flesh. You can hear Ephesians 5 here. And if they are one flesh and there is between them a true marriage, indeed the most perfect of all marriages, since human marriages are but poor examples of this one true marriage, it follows that everything they have held in common, the good as well as the evil. Accordingly, the believing soul can boast of and glory in whatever Christ has as though it were its own. Union with Christ. And not just Luther, but Calvin too, some years later. This is what he wrote in the Institutes of 1559. We must now see in what ways we become possessed of the blessings which God has bestowed on his only begotten Son. Not for private use, he writes, but to enrich the poor and needy. And the first thing to be attended to is this, that so long as we are without Christ and separated from him, nothing which he suffered and did for the salvation of the human race is of the least benefit to us. To communicate to us the blessings which he received from the Father, he must become ours and dwell in us. Accordingly, he's called the head and the firstborn among many brethren, while on the other hand, we are said to be engrafted in him and clothed with him, all of which he possesses, being, as I have said, nothing to us until we become one with him. So then, coming back to today, here is my State of the Union address. And let's consider then this union with Christ in past perspective, present perspective, and in future perspective. And I'll draw on Paul's letters. For as I said, in many ways, the Reformation was a retrieval of Paul's gospel, gospel of grace. So let's start with union with Christ in past perspective. And we heard Romans 6 read to us, and that's a great passage for this. It's set in the context of Romans 1 to 11, where Paul is setting out the mercies of God. And in that chapter, I'll repeat it for us, it's so good, the reading of it, Paul launches into a series of rhetorical questions. Interestingly, there are about 60 rhetorical questions in Romans alone. One of the features, if I may say, of a really good communicator is asking questions and not just making statements. What shall we say then, he writes? Shall we go on sinning that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. For we have been united with him. That's that union note. We will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection if we've been united to him in a death like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we may no longer be slaves to sin, he says, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. Now we have died with Christ. We believe that we also live with him. Union with Christ means that we are related to the dying and rising of Jesus Christ in a relationally transformative way. Our autobiography takes a fresh turn, a turn symbolized in baptism. In fact, in the early church, usually at Easter time, to be baptized, you took off your old robes, the old life, as it were. You descended naked into the waters and were baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Then you ascended to be robed in a new garment, your new life. In fact, I'm reminded of that old plantation hymn, first published in 1899. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? In a sense, yes, I was. And yes, so were you. We were there, incorporated into him. Yes, because of our union with Christ. So paradoxically, I stand here on the one hand as a dead man walking, in a sense, and yet, on the other hand, I'm a newly alive person. A new creation is how Paul put it to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17. If anyone understood he or she, a new creation, the person who is in Christ. But what about the here and now? So next, let me say something about union with Christ in present perspective. And again, I'm drawing on that wonderful context of Romans chapters 1 to 11, where Paul sets out the mercies of God in the gospel. In chapter 8 and verse 1, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. No condemnation. Did you hear that? And then, right at the very end of the chapter, verse 37 and following, no, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. No separation. I'm reminded of that great 19th century Scottish preacher, Robert Murray McShane, and his idea that Paul's master principle was the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. A love that nothing can separate us from. No matter how anxious you may be sitting in that seat. Now let's be clear, union with Christ is not a matter of sight, it's a matter of faith. I can't see your union with Christ as I stand here, and you can't see my union with Christ, nor as a result our union with one another. So metaphysically speaking, we need a distinction at this point. You see, by definition, God is everywhere in his creative omnipresence. As Paul preached to the pagan intelligentsia in Acts 17, in him, that's in God, we live and move and have our being. But for God's people, there's also a redemptive presence, captured by that phrase, in Christ, over 70 times in the New Testament. And other phrases as such as with Christ or through Christ. In one sense, Christ is everywhere as God the Son, creative omnipresence, if you like. But in another sense, he's qualitatively in a different relation to believers. His redemptive presence, if you will. And the result is great assurance. In Christ, no condemnation. In Christ, no separation, as we saw in Romans 8. And may I ask, aren't these two truths the key to the joyful Christian life? You see, our relation to Christ makes an eternity of difference. So then, friends, we've looked back at our dying and rising with Christ, and we've looked around, as it were, no condemnation for us, no separation from Christ, for those united to him in the here and now. But what about the future? What about united with Christ in future perspective? And here I turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And the context is the troubles at Corinth that Paul has to pastorally deal with. And amongst them, wrong beliefs about the resurrection, even doubts. And in that context, in verses 20 to 22 of 1 Corinthians 15, Paul argues, "But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who've fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive." Now let me contrast Paul's bold hope with a very different scenario. I'm drawing on that famous unbeliever of the 20th century, actually, he was born in the 19th. Bertrand Russell, A Free Man's Worship of 1903. This is how he ends this essay. "Such an outline, but even more purposeless, more void of meaning, is the world which science presents for our belief." It's the world he believed in. "Amid such a world, if anywhere, our ideals henceforth must find a home. That man is the product of causes which had no prevision of the end they were achieving. That his origin, his growth, his hopes and fears, his loves and his beliefs are but the outcome of accidental collocations of atoms. That no fire, no heroism, no intensity of thought and feeling can preserve an individual life beyond the grave. That all the labors of the ages, all the devotion, all the inspiration, all the noonday brightness of human genius are destined to extinction in the vast death of the solar system. And that the whole temple of man's achievement must inevitably be buried beneath the debris of a universe in ruins. All these things, if not quite beyond dispute, are yet so nearly certain that no philosophy which rejects them can hope to stand." How cheery. But wait, there's more. And this is how it ends. Only within the scaffolding of these truths, only on the firm foundation of unyielding despair, can the soul's habitation henceforth be safely built. Well, let me ask scientifically, how might this happen? Well, there's the big freeze theory. We'll just get colder and colder as a universe until the temperature reaches absolute zero. And when that happens, the lights go out for good. And we end in the big freeze. And then there's the big rip theory. And that is, the universe will continually, indefinitely expand until everything in it can no longer hold together, and you've got it, the big rip. And then there's the big crunch theory. The expansion of the universe doesn't continue forever. Ultimately, it collapses back in on itself until we become a super dense black hole-like singularity. That sounds like very close fellowship. And lastly, and ghastly, the big slurp theory, which I tried to understand, but at least I got this from it. The universe as we know it, humanity with it, is annihilated in the end. Well, friends, no wonder that secularist Lord Blackham, humanist, wrote a book called Objections to Humanism, which he said in his opening sentence that the problem is humanism seems too bad to be true. Well, if you hold to these scenarios, you can see his point, but in contrast, union with Christ, your kingdom come, we pray. And in contrast to that, the loss of hope is devastating, isn't it? And Paul knew that. With gritty realism in 1 Corinthians 15, he says, if the dead are not raised, let's eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. I'm reminded of that great jazz singer Peggy Lee and her song, Is That All There Is? Is that all there is? Is that all there is? If that's all there is, my friends, let's keep dancing. Let's break out the booze and have a ball. If that's all there is. In July, I was in Australia. I was in a beautiful part of Sydney called the Peninsula, the Northern Beaches, only to find out from a local pastor, I was preaching at his church, that youth suicide was an enormous problem in that beautiful part of the world. Why? Because so many teenagers had just lost hope that there was a future worth believing in. They were loaded up with the goodies of this world. But what's the point? Being a Snapchat star wasn't enough. Maybe part of the problem. What a contrast to a Christian hope. Come with me to the second century, late second century, and to Irenaeus, Bishop of Lyon and Vienne. He knew what the union with Christ meant. He knew that the head of the body of Christ was with the Father, and where the head is, all the members will go. In fact, a generation earlier, there was a persecution in Lyon, Vienne. About 177 AD, Christians were not only killed, the pagans burnt their bodies and swept the ashes into the River Rhone so that they may not rise again. They knew that these Christians' lives were animated by their great hope. And that hope is predicated on our union with Christ, yours and mine. Not celestial retirement in the future, but a future world enlivenment that only the word glorification can make sense of. But finally, yes, but how? How can such a union be? Because there are many kinds of unions in our world. There are conjoined twins, physical unions. There is the union of those who support a football team. Roll Tide. War Eagle. In fact, my next door neighbor in Alabama, Philip, wouldn't date any woman wearing orange. That was the auburn colour. But we're thinking about our union with Christ. How about that? Here I think our pneumatology, the doctrine of the Spirit, comes in. The Spirit that animated Christ's humanity animates our own. We're the temples of the Spirit. I think Calvin got it so right. The Holy Spirit is the bond which unites us with Christ. This is a result of faith produced by the secret operation of the Holy Spirit. Union with Christ is a matter of relation rather than physical location. And to be united with Christ is to belong to Him now and forever and to one another. So, friends, by the grace of God, we have all joined the union. It's a union not of our own making. And the good news of the gospel is that the union dues were paid for us. Paid for us on the cross. And underwritten for us by that resurrection from the dead. No condemnation. No separation. No hopelessness. Thanks be to God, we stand united. Now that is worth a celebration. Let's bow our heads in prayer once more. O Lord, as your servant Calvin said, sometimes matters of religion may simply flit around in our brains. So work in us by your Spirit, I pray, that the deep truths of union with Christ, your Son, may so penetrate the recesses of our hearts that we may be filled with joy and peace in believing. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.